Welcome to the Innovation and Technology Management Seminar Series hosted by the Engineering Management Program in the Pratt School of Engineering at Duke University. My name is Jeff Glass, and I'm the Faculty Director for the Engineering Management Program. The purpose of our seminar series is to introduce engineers and scientists to various business and management concepts that they will find useful throughout their careers. Speakers represent a diverse array of industries from finance and information technology to materials processing and biotechnology. If you'd like to learn more about the Engineering Management Program at Duke, including these podcasts and any associated audiovisual materials that are sometimes available, please visit our website at memp.duke.edu. Thanks for your interest in our series, and please do not hesitate to contact us with suggestions or questions.
Thank you, John. I only speak one language. I don't speak that very well, so I'm not going to translate. John asked me to give a history of Gilbane. We were founded in 1873 by Tom and Bill Gilbane and still run today by the fourth generation Tom and Bill, and our fifth generation, our sixth generation are working for the company. We have over 2,500 employees. We have 60 offices worldwide. So now I'm going to give you a short video that we ran for our 140th anniversary last year.
Gilbane is a family company. A family company that's 140 years old.
I love to talk about a family business. I think about family businesses all the time. When you're brought up in one, and it's your family, your name is on that door, you think about it, you start thinking about it in that context, but it's amazing to me that I quickly forgot that. I quickly learned that working at Gilbane made me part of one big, large family.
When I think of a family company, I think of not the Gilbanes and Choquettes and Broderick's. I think of all the employees within the company.
Our people that I am working with on a daily basis are some of the best friends I have in life. They're the people I trust the most. They're the people I've shared success with and also mourned with.
So when I think of family, I think of all the employees in the company. And, you know, when times get tough, the family that you depend on, that you lean on, that you look for, help and assistance. And I think that's one of the great things we have. We've got people who care for each other every day and support each other, are excited about the good things others are doing.
You all make Gilbane a very special place. You help each other on a daily basis to live better lives, to accomplish more as individuals, to be excellent at what you do. Our family culture is not the Gilbane family culture. It's Gilbane. Not isolated to that. It's about the whole family.
So from my perspective, I want to thank all of you for being part of our family. Thanks for what you do every day. Thanks for the support you provide our customers. And thanks for all you do to support those within the company.
That video pretty much defines Gilbane. We are a family company, six generations, and it really defines how we do our business, because we treat all our clients, architects, engineers, and employees as one big family. So I'm the project, just real quick, over the years, the World War II Memorial in D.C., Vietnam Memorial, Visitor Center. We're making a lot of Corona beer down in Mexico now, $1 billion beer plant. We're doing the headquarters for Exxon Mobil. We did 500 different projects for NASA. We didn't build the one that just crashed last week. I'm sad to say it crashed, and I'm glad to say we didn't build it. The Smithsonian here, Lake Placid Olympics, Orlando Airport, and the San Jose Airport I did myself. With that, I'll turn it over to Mike.
I'm Mike Benson. I'm the Gilbane Pre-Construction Manager in North Carolina. Done a number of jobs here at Duke, currently working on your health and wellness project, which is going to be going in at the corner of Tower View and Union. My job is pretty much what it sounds like. It's prior to construction starting, so all the budgeting, constructability, scheduling, logistics, things of that nature, they fall under my purview. I'd like to expand a little bit more on some of our experience in North Carolina. We started in North Carolina in 1976. And what better way to start with another brewery, the Miller Brewery this time. A little bit of a beer theme going here. Continued on in doing more projects. We're going to highlight some of the more notable ones here in North Carolina. GlaxoSmithKline campus. We did 1.6 million square feet of that campus in 1995. One of the largest pharmaceutical complexes in the country. We also worked at the EPA in 2002, another very large campus, 1.2 million square feet this time. And that was really on the leading edge of being environmentally conscious construction, LEED being a very important thing now, and green building. This was really at the forefront of that, as you would expect with a client like the EPA. 2006, we were over at, I don't know if I'm allowed to say this here, NC State. Is that okay? and that was for a chilled water plant, 12,000 ton capacity, which is significant. Currently, we're working on a project called Project Cardinal in the western part of the state, which is a very large data center project. And another large data center project is ongoing right now, and it's coming up out of the ground here locally for a confidential client, but it is in Zebulon. 150,000 square feet of data center. Pretty interesting projects. More specifically, and maybe more important to you, some of the work we've done here at Duke, the Health and Wellness Center, which I mentioned earlier, these are just some renderings of what you will eventually see. As I mentioned, we're in pre-con right now, but that's 75,000 square feet, 22 million, also a LEED building. The powerhouse renovation for TIP, We just recently completed that, and we also are currently working on TIP's prior location in the Coca-Cola building, the old Coca-Cola headquarters, over on Main Street. That was 16,000 square feet, so a small one, but always interesting when they're historical renovations. It's always nice to preserve that.
Back to you.
Students always ask me what my favorite project was. I think I got asked that yesterday by the gentleman here. And I always come up with the same couple, three projects. And I will show you a video related to that in a second. But first I wanted to show you, in the past 4 years, the involvement we've had on campus. We've been to Frontiers, we've been to Tech Connect, we're on the Pratt board, and we're teaching courses. Through all that, we've actually hired 10 Duke students in the past 4 years alone, and we just hired one last night, I hope. We're in reviewing regularly, and I'm going to continue that for as long as I'm alive, I can tell you that, because I want to give back to Duke. With that, we'll go into the video that kind of talks about my three favorite projects. You'll see a relevance here.
During holiday travel, some people get delirious. Delayed. And some get Del Griffin.
American Light and Fixture, Director of Sales, Shower Curtain Ring Division.
Neil Page got all three.
I was on my way home to spend a nice holiday with my family. Instead, I'm in a motel bed with a stranger.
So instead of Thanksgiving with his family, he's spending 3 days with the turkey.
Two happy clams just whistling down the road.
Flintstones, meet the Flintstones, they're the modern family.
Paramount Pictures presents
Wilma!
Steve Martin.
You ever been to Hawaii?
Yeah.
You see Don Ho while you were there?
See the second show, that's the best one.
Is that right?
Yeah.
John Candy.
Why are you holding my hand? Where's your other hand? Between two pillows.
Those aren't pillows.
Planes, trains, and automobiles.
See that Bears game last week?
Yeah, color game, color game.
If you haven't seen that movie, I highly recommend it. I've watched it like 20 times. But Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. One of my most recent projects, and as a structural engineer, most exciting projects. We dug a hole 1,600 feet long, about 150 feet wide, 20 feet deep. The water table was at grade, so we were 20 feet below the water table for the foundation for this new terminal building in San Jose. And this is the finished product. I'm very proud of that. My son was the one that took these pictures, actually. And it was a large project, 245,240,000 square feet. Next one is the trains piece of it. This is my single most important project that I've built. We were asked to relocate 14 miles of railroad over to this area and relocate this river and that river to create space for the brand new train station in Providence. We had to install that new train station over active tracks, and that was the main line track going north-south, brake rail, light rail, etc. So like I said, we relocated two rivers, 14 miles of track, parking garages, etc. The river here, I think it's called the Providence Firewalk, I think it is, if you guys have seen it. They put on a wonderful fire show. When we got there in 83 to relocate to the river was burning then, but it wasn't on purpose. It was so dirty and so contaminated that the methane or whatever was coming off the bottom would actually ignite. So we cleaned up the rivers, relocated them. Now, if you're downtown Providence, it's a really nice experience. And then the cars piece of it, I worked on the Framingham plant for General Motors. We've actually built 42 projects for General Motors, and that was a fantastic project just because of the sheer size of it. And I remember halfway through construction, they changed model numbers, discontinued the model of a car, and we had to totally redesign the entire structure while we were building the structure around it. So a lot of fun on that project. So that's Planes, Trains, and Automobiles.
Good afternoon, everybody. Can y'all hear me okay? Everything's good? All right.
So my name is Jonathan Ammon. I flew in from Boston this morning, so I have really no connection to either Duke or UNC, so I'll leave that completely out of the conversation for this morning. But missing Halloween to come down here was actually really nice. I've had a few friends that came to Duke, and they had a great experience, so I really, really hope y'all are enjoying your college experience and things like that. I walked around here earlier and started to look at some of the sites and to see some of the mechanical, some of the elements you guys are building around here. It looks really cool. Saw some awesome tracks. Saw some plane made out of styrofoam or something. Anybody have anything to do with that? I'd love to pick your brain and talk about it. Basically, my role up in Boston and in Phoenix, I'm going to Toronto on Tuesday, get down to Texas for some other projects. I really kind of go all over the state and the country to kind of basically play with toys, which is kind of nice. So for anybody that's, you know, wants to start thinking about an involvement in terms of construction that's maybe outside of the procurement of trades and the actual sequencing of systems, to actually start thinking about what are the opportunities in terms of technology, in terms of software, in terms of building systems and the applications of these types of systems so as to build a building better, maybe build it faster, build it cheaper, and again, getting back into quality, getting back into design. A lot of the time I have, I spend with, you know, vice principals of vice presidents of the company or owners of other companies, everyone down to the trades that have been out into the field, and the Boston accents, let me tell you, they are thick. I'm from the Southwest, so I understand about half of what they say. So basically, it's usually the pictures try to speak 1,000 words that we draw. So, you know, let me talk about a couple of just basically the technological elements that are coming into the industry. So again, in the back of your mind, really think about, like, why would I go to work for a construction firm, okay? And one of the reasons I'd like y'all to think about is because the technology that is not yet in the industry and the software that is pervading the industry, and quite frankly, like facile, very smart people like yourself in this room can create an incredible opportunity for themselves and change the game of construction and do a lot of really good work. And I'm very fortunate to work with some people like that. So I want to tell you, you have a lot of opportunity in the world of construction through the application of technology and the application of software. So if that's something that y'all are thinking about doing and you want to get into, you know, my contact information is here and we'll be able to get in touch in whatever way, shape, or form. Please, open door, don't hesitate. Really can't get enough smart minds to come and do this kind of work. So last Saturday morning, I drove out to the project that I recently helped build. It's the reason why I moved to Boston. And I took the drone out that I get to fly around on project sites and take a look at things. It's a great little toy to fly around. So y'all have seen it, y'all have done it. Next thing comes back to the laser scanner. So the laser scanning, creating a three-dimensional point cloud, I mean, literally down to like 0.1% of a millimeter accuracy, more or less, to some spaces, depending on how well it's actually scanned and then put together. Turning that into then a building information model, getting that to an owner, getting that to an architect, getting that to an engineer so that they actually have the as-built conditions for which they can design to. And there's a lot of, again, and these kind of things had not yet really been in the industry, at least the construction management teams were using 5 years ago. So I've seen this really take off in the last couple of years. So next is, when does this basically meet that? Now look, we know that this technology is out there. Again, y'all have probably seen a lot of this, read a lot about this. Hell, some of the people in this room had actually even built this, and I wouldn't be surprised if that's actually the case. But when you think about it, one of these days, this drone that's here, that's $200,000, $250,000, the one that I bought, the one that I used, is $1,500 out the door. Put a laser scanner on that to actually go in through site, look at the site from above, see all the elements, see how it's going. I mean, it's just the sharing, the creation, and the yielding of as much information as possible, which basically gets everybody to see something at the same time. So as much as real-time information we can we get real-time laser scanning? I contend that we can one of these days. For anybody that saw Ridley Scott's Prometheus movie a couple of years ago, you know that character David throws those spheres up that somehow defy gravity. I don't know, maybe someone in this room figures out how to do that. That'd be great. And can actually go through the actual space and real-time upload all of that to a spaceship, you know, a couple miles away. So one, now I really believe that. One thing I'm working on right now, and it sounds pretty simple, and it doesn't seem, again, this is just a really good example as to the technology that's coming into the industry that's not yet there, is you have a GoPro or you have a drone or you have a GoPro on a drone like we do, and what I'd like to do is to be able to say, okay, Bob's in his project, Bob's in his office, and he's working on one of five or six projects. I'm 200 miles or I'm 100 miles away, and I'm flying through the space in real time, and on his screen, he's seeing what I'm seeing through the iPad, which is coming through the actual GoPro. That technology is out there. It's used all over the world, but again, it's not yet made its way into construction. And that is one of 1,000 different areas where it hasn't yet come into this industry. And that's what I mean about open sky and open opportunity. Oculus, reality capture, you know, that's what we're going to hear about from here today. That is just going to get, that's a big game changer, the reality capture. And then even getting so far as to talking specifically to construction for a moment is we see a design here, but what someone might see that's been in the field for a long time or that knows the operations and knows the procurement and knows the sequencing of how these systems come together might be able to look at an architect's design and say, okay, good design has nothing to do with that. It's this scope isn't included. What are you going to do about air conditioning? What are you going to do about electrical systems? What are you going to do about mechanical? Start to ask these types of questions. So that is going to yield a better design and a better building in a shorter, faster, and hopefully cheaper time. Three-dimensional printing. Let's just change the conversation up and just kind of talk something, holy cow, kind of different things. I know a lot of people here have seen 3D printing. I love the fact that it's getting into the medical issues. You know, my father with the heart issue, you know, possibly like printing an aorta for something along those lines. You get this. Take three-dimensional printing. Take concrete, for example. I think that in our lifetime, this might legitimately happen is, what's it going to take to three-dimensionally print a building? Quite simple when you think about it, is rather than just pour the concrete, just print the concrete. I literally think this is what's happening right now because, as we see, this has happened in China. I think it's in Beijing. I don't know quite where it was, but literally printing the 3D, printing the concrete separately, and then just putting it together on site. I'm a big believer in this kind of stuff. I think this can actually work, and frankly, I think it can legitimately change the game. And what game might it actually change? Like, I hope that I'll be here the day that a person walks on Mars. Like I said, hopefully it's someone in this room. Really, puts a Duke decal on your astronaut jacket or whatever the heck you're going to call it, all right? And, like, really represent that. I'd like to see you. UNC's not going to one-up that one, let me tell you. So, so then if you get, you're going into the KC-135, and they're legitimately printing these things while they're actually trying to define gravity to see what's the printer going to do? What's this material going to do? Because one day, we're going to be there. I hope that we're going to be there. And this is, I'd say, look, I think it's feasible to actually print this rather than just to ship all the information, all the building materials up there. I think that's definitely in the realm of possibility. One other idea in the model, just want to see how we're doing on time. I seem to be good. There's a concept that's going on out there that I really like. I was talking about this yesterday. Now, look, this is a very vanilla model. I'll be very frank with you, okay? But the idea is this. If we talk about the sequencing of a building, typically, obviously, you pour your foundations and you build bottom up. Concrete, steel goes in, then you sequence everything else, maybe bring your mechanicals in, facade starts to come, you know, and you start to get your piping in. There's always been a system or a sequence that's been followed in order to actually do this. So some engineers I was working with yesterday are just want to change the game a little bit. So they say, okay, can we build it top down? That's the idea. So what's it going to take to build top down? And their sequence is if you build your course first, you place your roof steel, then you bring in your roof steel, then your architecture or your mechanical elements, you lift it 6 feet up. Why would we lift it 6 feet up? I'd actually like to hear from somebody in the room. If I'm going to build something 11 stories, and the first story is going to go up to the roof, just take a wild guess, please, raise your hand and tell me, why do we lift it 6 feet before we bring it to the very top? Don't all yell at me at once here. Pardon?
Make sure it doesn't collapse.
That's okay, so you got a safety factor. Exactly, you're hired. Next. What else we got? What else? Why would we want to look underneath of something before we lift it up?
Eye section?
Yeah,
like it's the strongest section there.
Okay, no, that's a good point. I like that. That's not where I'm going. You look like you were going to say something, miss.
Well, I guess make sure that the foundation, like the earth beneath it.
Is everything's good. Okay, so I like the safety factor. Yes, sir.
People can easily walk beneath it.
Pardon?
People don't have to bend down while walking.
You got it. Okay, so let's go with that. So if you're going to lift it up 6 feet, and most people, you know, say 6 feet, they're going to install the systems underneath that floor so that when you get to the next floor below, the systems on the ceiling are already installed. That's the idea. So you pour your foundation, you lift it up 6 feet, you install all the mechanical elements, and you pop it up, you know, 11 stories in the air. Then you place your steel, you pour your concrete, you put your prefabrication materials in there, you build your walls, you lift it 6 feet, you install your MEP, you pop it up 11 feet. And this goes on and on and on and on and on all the way until the building is actually complete. And again, this idea alone absolutely changes the game in ways that like we might not even consider right now. So the procurement, the purchasing of all of the stuff that goes into it, I can't tell you enough. One of the biggest challenges I had on that project that I took the photo of with the drone is that the reason why the project kind of crept along and crept along is because the owner wasn't making the decisions to buy, say, the generator and all these other big elements that need to be part of the project. Whereas with this, everything needs to be bought early. So you're sequencing and you're bringing things and you're procuring everything together a lot quicker. So again, game-changing kind of ideas. Next. Okay, so yeah, I like this. I like this one. Mike and I were talking about this and we brought this up. So tunnel boring, okay? So if we take, say, the Bosphorus, for example, and you're looking at where, like, you know, east and west meet. When they do the tunnel diggers, you know, you have two that basically go into the ground, and this is one way of doing it. It's not the only way to do it, but you have two. They go into the ground, one on one side, one on the other. They go under the water, and they go towards. And right before they meet, one dives into the ground, and the other just goes through, and they pull that one out, and then the other stay. That's more or less the idea. And it's cost-effective, and it works. So the question then becomes, and I love this, people brought this up, and I'm like, wow, this is kind of a cool idea, is that with these cranes, we had a tower crane going on right over here before when we were driving in. A couple of common elements to all these tower cranes is the actual structure itself. So the question then becomes is, why not just make the structure of the crane part of the structure of the building? So might we one day be in a case where the actual crane is the core of the building, rather than just pouring the core, just make the element that the crane's going to use the core of the building, so that when the building is complete and all the elements are installed up top, you just take the top off with another crane and then you pull it down and that's it. I mean, those are the kind of ideas that could legitimately work. And again, I think, you know, we talk about the rate of change that takes place with the way technology affects industry, the way technology actually changes the way people do things. I've been in the construction industry for maybe 5 years, architect working before that, and I started off just doing simple software, just Revit software in and of itself, and the amount of change that I've seen in the industry has just gotten faster and faster, and it's kind of crazy to think of how fast it goes, and I love the fact that it's like the people in the room that are really going to be pushing that, because when we're getting to the point where we're legitimately building buildings that are a mile high, it can't be done, in my book, with current technology. It needs to get smarter, and that's exactly where it's going. So again, when you think about, go to this great university, studying mechanical engineering, structural, electrical, do I really want to go work for a construction firm? And I say that very respectfully to everybody in the room. I really can't tell you enough the opportunities that are out there for you to differentiate yourselves, to change the game, and to bring technology into a completely new industry. It's a really open sky, and it's really something I would consider. The last point I'll make before, you know, moving on to the next, is this idea, stigmergy. Kind of weird. I think I'm saying it right. Autonomous robotic construction crews. I kind of like this idea. This came out of MIT and Harvard. This is pretty wacko stuff, but I love the idea. I saw somebody in one of these rooms and that was building these, looks like he's a mechanical driver, these mechanical cars going around. It was like splayed out on the floor, like playing with this thing. It was actually pretty awesome. I wanted to talk about what he was doing, but we had to come in here. And so what the idea is, like, thinking about what ants do and thinking about the ways in which termites build buildings is there's not some queen out there like dictating and directing where everyone's going. It's these simple organisms that are building a composite based off of inputs from its surrounding context. And it's using that context to basically guide and make its decisions. So that's what happened with the pyramids a long time ago. Now I know there was like the whole slavery and people getting, you know, killed and beaten to do that. Obviously we're not there anymore, thank God. But the point being is that they just knew where they had to put the elements to build the overall composite. Now, that is very feasible when it comes to robotics in this day and age, as to how can a building get built accordingly. And again, that might be a very feasible possibility. That's something that MIT and Harvard have been collaborating on and really talking about. So with that, turn it over. Miss?
All right. So I'm going to kind of tie it all together a little bit, talk about how at Duke right now we are using some of these technologies in the construction industry. And briefly to introduce myself, my name is Rachel Fleming. I was a civil engineering student here, graduated in 2012, and then I was in the MEng program in civil engineering after that. During my undergraduate, in our structural engineering capstone course, and I don't know if any of you are familiar with the course or maybe know some students who are in the course, what our project is to design the structure of a building. We work with the architectural class. They give us our floor plan and our layout. And the environmental class, they look at the rainwater and the environment around the building. And we design the actual structure. We use our concrete design courses and our steel design courses to design the structure. This is the Revit model of my structural capstone project. And I have the binder and some drawings up here if anybody's interested in looking at it afterward. So we work all semester to do all of our design calculations. What's our dead load? What's our live load? What's the space going to be used for to come up with this design? And we've been working on it all semester. We have the entire model in Revit, which is a great start. The next piece brings the dive into it. So once we have our model in Revit, at the very end of the semester, we get to see all the hard work we put into it. You could go to the next slide. Thanks. This is a picture of sort of what our Revit model would look like in the dive so that you guys can see. We actually get to go into the dive with our model and walk through the structure of this building. So we got to walk around our footings, we got to jump upstairs, look at our design, how would it actually look like in real life if you were on the construction site walking through it. And the picture on the right just shows, for example, we had to decide where our lateral bracing was going to go, if we wanted to use chevron bracing or diagonal bracing, and kind of what that would look like. So we got to walk through our building 3D. Now, this is just the structure of a building, but we have models that go much further than just the structure, where you could actually bring an owner, a client, potential project, walk them physically through their building in the dive, in an immersive virtual environment. And this is kind of the first step for that project that I wanted to give you guys that introduction to. And now to learn a little bit more about the dive, Dr. Hedges-Copper is going to go into some more of that technology there.
Thanks, Rachel.
Okay. Right, yeah, thanks for leading in, and I think it's great that Gilbane is doing this partnership with Duke, and it's just a great opportunity. And I'm going to talk a little about how we can use immersive virtual reality to visualize engineering structures. Okay, so first, I think most of you are familiar with the dive, but for the ones who aren't, it's an immersive room, literally that you walk into and you have a cube with screens all around you, and it's also interactive, so you get your head and hand to be tracked so that the perspective view is correct based on where you're looking, and you can manipulate things in the environment. Of course, it's stereoscopic, so just like when you go to watch a 3D movie, you get that third dimension depth perception. In the dive, you get that as well. But more than that, you're surrounded by the environment. So you get things you really perceive after you are in the environment for a while. You start actually almost believing that stuff that things are really right in front of you. It supports multiple users, which is interesting because you can get somewhat of a social experience that you don't get in with head-mounted displays. And the dive is really a unique infrastructure, so I think every Duke student should take advantage of that. There's only a handful of other comparable systems in the world, and we are very lucky to have something like that here. Okay, so currently the dive, you may also have noticed that we are offline and we are undergoing renovation. So we have six projectors, basically one projector per each screen, and a total of about 6 megapixels. So about 1 million pixels for each screen. And I should have said it's a 10 by 10 foot environment. So it's 10 by 10 by 10 feet. And we can show models of about 2 to 3 million polygons in terms of the complexity of the model. So recently we got an award from NSF to upgrade it, and we're going to make it really state of the art now. We're going to have 12 projectors, now with 2 projectors per screen stacked together, and with a total of about 24 million pixels, 4 times as much as we have in the dive. We're going to be able to, we're changing our back-end render structure so that we're going to be able to manipulate in real time much more complex models. The tracking is going to be better. We're not going to have blind spots like sometimes we have now. And we're going to go online in the spring. So this, I think, the practicum with Gilbane is going to be a great opportunity for us to use the dive with a very high resolution and models that are rather complex for you guys to visualize the beam structures. Okay, we also have some other VR infrastructure. Like you've seen before, we have two Oculus Rifts. We have a Z-Space, which is an immersive workbench, which is interesting for sort of single-person work that's not so much of first-person immersive, but you can get, for example, a model and look at the model from a bird's-eye perspective very, very effectively. We also have, in terms of development, we're able to develop in Unity 3D, and we have tools that allow us to very easily go from different devices, from the dive to an Oculus Rift, and even to the web, only with changes to the user interface, but not to the code itself. We also have other tracking systems such as Leap Motion that allows you to do finger manipulations. Okay, so now I'm just going to talk a little bit about it's actually C429, which I think Rachel was talking about, this capstone course. It's been done for the past few years with the dive visualization, and the students basically bring their project to the dive, and they can inspect it. One nice thing about the dive is that you can analyze your design from different perspectives. So you're literally flying around the model, and here you can see that there's like a view of the structure from far away. You can go inside and you can see different things. So these are some pictures that are very similar to what Rachel showed. And here are a couple pictures of the users in action. So here you get an idea of the scale that really, I mean, if you're not paying a lot of attention, you could believe that someone is really inside a room there. So that's what I had, and I guess the floor is open for questions now.